Done. 3, 2, 1, go.
Good morning. I'm Reverend Jamie Michaels, and together with the staff and leadership of Old South United Methodist Church, I'm delighted to welcome you once again to this virtual space of worship. If you've enjoyed our online worship, take a moment to like and follow our Facebook page or subscribe on YouTube. And share these messages with your family and friends so we can share the good news of joy, hope, love, and peace with as many people as possible. Today we continue a 4-week worship series called On God's Quarantine. Realizing that the game of life has changed for us during this COVID crisis, we are looking at how God's rules of living help us play the game differently. I know lots of you are missing summer sports, so I hope you'll all wear your favorite team's jersey or gear to your worship at home space and join us at Zoom coffee hour after to represent for your team. I, of course, am repping Team Jesus, and you are all invited to cheer for that team. Now let's get our hearts, our minds, and our bodies ready for worship. Sit up nice and tall. Draw your attention to your breath. Maybe close your eyes if you want to. Remember that God made us, humankind, by breathing into us God's very spirit, the breath of life. As you breathe in, imagine that spirit enters in with your breath and fills you up, starting with your belly and then all the way out to your fingers and toes. As you breathe out, all of the stress and anxiety, the cobwebs that build up in our heads, leave your body with your exhale. As you breathe in and breathe out, listen to this prelude played by Team Organ, a one-woman team named Adriana. As you breathe, prepare your body and your spirit for worship. Good morning. Again, I'm Reverend Jamie Michaels. I'm pastor here at Old South United Methodist Church. We're a reconciling congregation, which means that no matter who you are, no matter where you are on your journey of faith, no matter whom you love, You are welcome here. Our mission statement helps us to remember who we are and whose we are. Will you join me in saying it together now? As disciples of Jesus Christ, we welcome all, experience God, transform lives, and act justly. If you're visiting with us for the very first time in this online space, a special welcome to you. We're so excited that you chose to worship with us today. We'd love to get to know you. Our virtual connect card is linked in the comments below or the description if you're on YouTube. Please take a moment to let us know that you're here. You can always learn more about Old South Church by visiting us at our website, www.oldsouthumc.org. Immediately after worship, you're all invited to join us together in our Zoom coffee hour. The link is on the Facebook page or in the description below. Just bring your own coffee and your own team's jersey, and we'd love to see you there. My friends, I'm so glad that we can be together in this way as we seek to build the kingdom of heaven here on earth together. As we begin our worship, let's light our Christ candles as Julia and Micah lead us in our call to worship.
Please join together in our call to worship, printed on your screen.
The game has changed, but God is the same.
The rules of the world are different now,
but God's law never changes. The turf may be rough,
but we've got the best coach. We know we can do it.
When we play for God's team.
Please join together in singing the opening hymn wherever you are.
Changed? How do we measure up when the scorekeeping is brand new? Meet us on the field, God. Coach us through our practice, teach us your rules, and how to play in this new game. Train us up so we have the strength to follow you, no matter how hard the course gets. Amen.
Amen.
My friends, Jesus, our brother, said, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Peace not as the world gives, but as I give. So let not your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid." I invite you to share the peace of Christ now with one another in the comments below.
Hi, friends. I just want to say first how much I miss seeing all of you. It just isn't the same not getting to talk to you face to face and hear all about your week at school and all of your favorite things. Today I want to tell you guys a story about something I did when I was much younger. I was in middle school, actually. Every summer, the church that I went on a big mission trip to some place in the United States where we would work in the community and host Bible clubs for the kids in the evenings. One year, we went to a reservation. A reservation is land that the United States government set aside for Native Americans. But it isn't always nice to live on a reservation. The Native American tribes who live there are often very poor and sometimes have difficulty finding work and maintaining their homes. Many of them also have health problems and need special assistance. While we were there, we helped to build ramps for the front of their homes, we mowed their lawns, painted houses, and even helped them clean up if they needed a little bit of extra help with that. And then at night, we led programs with the kids. One of the coolest parts about being there was that we got to learn about the culture of the people who lived on the reservation, and we got to share ours with them. We listened to one another, and through the stories, we realized that even though our beliefs were different, we looked different, and we lived in very different places, we actually had a lot in common. We learned to celebrate the ways that we were different because they were special and unique to ourselves and our families. We had a song that we did every night at the camps that I wanted to share with you today. The lyrics remind us that God made all kinds of people in all colors, shapes, and sizes. He loves them very much, and what we need to realize is that calling people names because they're different is wrong. Instead, we need to look on them in love and sing this song. I hope you guys really enjoy this song. I love it, and I'll be singing along.
Seen a boy with funny clothes? A girl with braces on her teeth or freckles on her nose? Some kids call them oddballs. Some kids call them weird.
Is it my imagination or does Aunt Ruth have a beard?
God makes lots of people in all colors, shapes, and sizes. He loves them very much, and what we need to realize is that calling people names because they're different is wrong. Instead, we need to look on them in love and sing this song.
I can't be your friend. I can be your friend. Any day and any weather, we can be friends and play together.
Yeah, we're all pretty different. Some are skinny, some are stout.
But the inside is the part that we're supposed to care about.
That's why we've got feelings that are very much the same.
And so instead of weirdo, I think that's a better name.
I can't be your friend.
Like I said, I really love that song, and I hope you guys enjoyed it too. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you that you've created us just the way we are, and you love us no matter what. Help us to be good friends and good allies to those around us. Help us to love them like you do. Be with us now and forever. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hello and welcome to Last Up First, the only sports show out there where the nice guys and gals finish first. As you all know, we play by Jesus rules here on Last Up First. That means that every week we're trying to figure out how we can best love God and love our neighbor, even now in the era of coronavirus and social distancing. The COVID crisis has devastated economies, systems, families, and individuals across the globe, but its effects are most keenly felt by those who were already marginalized through poverty, illness, and oppression. So when students at the United Methodist School Africa University in Zimbabwe found out that some of their neighbors were experiencing extreme hardship during the COVID pandemic, they took action. They decided to miss one meal per week at the school. The funds saved by skipping this meal purchased basic staples like salt, juice, poultry, and peanut butter for neighbors in need. Pastors in surrounding areas identified particularly vulnerable families to receive the benefit generated by the 200 plus students who remain in residence at the university because travel restrictions prohibit them from returning to their home countries. In recent days, Africa University has also channeled its resources towards producing much-needed supplies for the community. The university has begun making alcohol-based hand sanitizer, donating 1,000 liters of the disinfectant to the Old Mutare Mission Hospital. They've also developed a disposable mask prototype, while students have manufactured reusable cloth masks. These are chilling times, my friends, but the race of faith around the globe continues through the endurance of disciples like these. Our top story tonight comes again from Rome, where Coach Paul is encouraging the fledgling church to embody that same endurance. Today, he tells them that their baptism is the key to unlocking their freedom in Christ. For more on this story, we're joined by our field correspondent, Matt. Matt, thanks again for being with us.
Glad to be back, Jamie.
Matt, last week on the program, we heard Paul coaching the young church in Rome to stick it out through suffering because, as we saw, suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint. What does Coach Paul have to say to the team this week?
Well, Paul is telling the players a lot this week about sin and death. But what he's actually saying to them is, today is a new day. Forget what happened yesterday. Because of our baptism, today is a new match, and you can put it all behind you when you get on the field.
Well, that's a message we could all use. Let's hear some of Paul's speech. We're picking up midway through. Now, Paul has just talked about God's grace, which is a forgiveness that covers sin. Let's take a listen. So what do we do? Keep on sinning so God can keep on forgiving? I should hope not. If we've left the country where sin is sovereign, how can we still live in our old house there? Or didn't you realize we packed up and left there for good? That this is what happened in our baptism. When we went under the water, we left the old country of sin behind. When we came up out of the water, we entered into the new country of grace, a new life in a new land. That's what baptism into the life of Jesus means. When we're lowered into the water, it's like the burial of Jesus. When we're raised up out of the water, it's like the resurrection of Jesus. Each of us is raised into a light-filled world by our Father so we can see where we're going in our new grace-sovereign country. Could it be any clearer? Our old way of life was nailed to the cross with Christ, a decisive end to that sin-miserable life, no longer at sin's every beck and call. What we believe is this. If we get included in Christ's sin-conquering death, we also get included in his life-saving resurrection. We know that when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was a signal of the end of death as the end. Never again will death have the last word. When Jesus died, he took sin down with him, but alive, he brings God down to us. From now on, think of it this way. Sin speaks a dead language that means nothing to you. God speaks your mother tongue, and you hang on every word. You are dead to sin and alive to God. That's what Jesus did.
Yeah, so Paul is saying no matter what you have done, no matter what path your past has led you on, baptism into Jesus is a turning point for you. You get to start from zero again. No deficit, no coming from behind.
And Matt, why is that? Why is life in Jesus so different from life before?
Well, Paul says that we are baptized not only into life of Jesus, but into his death. For Paul, that means that our former lives, the lives in the country where sin is sovereign, actually died with Christ on the cross.
Wow, I see. If a life ruled by sin has died with Jesus, then we're free to live brand new lives, not governed or bound by those old forces.
Right. The Romans need to consider their old sin-filled lives to be dead. If they think of themselves as living in a brand new reality governed by love, they have every possibility of leaving the poor performance in the past and bringing their all to the new match.
Yeah, so I want to really bring it home for our viewers because we're living right now through a time that feels really heavy. Take a look at this training diagram. Now, these players are deep in defensive territory. There are forces of death all around them. There's no prevailing ethic of love, grace, or forgiveness, so they feel all alone out there. So what do? They build up some defenses: addiction, jealousy, anger, pride, judgment, greed, indifference, heartlessness. They put up stakes and try to keep others out because they're afraid there aren't enough resources to protect more than themselves. They start believing these lies, the ones that say, you have the best defenses, so you must be better than everyone else. The ones that say, amass more stuff, you'll get more because others exist to get less. The lies that say, if other people are suffering, it's because they don't want success as much as you do. They should try harder to protect themselves.
Right. And the defenses make sense at the time. People are trying to run away from these death-dealing forces, but they don't realize that their defense, their sin, is killing them.
Right. But then they meet Jesus, and he says, you don't have to live in defensive territory. Come with me to this other place. And now you'd expect it to be offensive territory, but actually God's rules don't make us go on the offense. So let's just call it free-fensive territory. That place where you'll be living free, free from living inside these walls, free from this separation, free from the fear of all of this death.
Just one catch. You have to leave this behind.
Exactly. Jesus says that this sin-filled way back there, we have to get rid of that. It's dead now. In my death, Jesus says, I am breaking down these walls that you've built. And that might be painful and scary because you've come to depend on them. But trust me, he says, what's over here is much better.
And that's where Paul's message from last week comes in. That breaking down of walls, the dismantling of those sin defenses, that is painful work that feels like suffering. But remember, suffering leads to endurance, leads to character, leads to hope.
That's right. And hope is what we find in the free-fensive place. This is the place that our hearts live after we've been baptized into Jesus. In this place, we're free from the fear of death because we have already died to our former lives, and now our lives belong to God. There's no need to build up those sin defenses anymore.
Okay, but it's not really that easy, is it?
No. This is tough, and these players are coming with all of these habits and patterns, and all they know how to do is build up those sin defenses. So baptism isn't a once and for all end to sin. It just means that we don't live in the death-dealing, defensive territory anymore. And over here in free-fensive land, we get to knock down those walls over and over and over again until we learn not to build them anymore.
Yes, and this is what John Wesley called moving on to perfection. If Jesus' grace saves us, it's God's perfecting grace that keeps us grounded here in the free-fensive zone.
And you viewers at home, you can work on this too. Prayer can be a training drill. Helping us to remember that we are living under God's reality, not under the tyranny of those death-dealing forces. When you're feeling afraid or ashamed or angry or just distant from God, take 3 deep breaths. Envision yourself stepping out of the defensive zone and try this prayer. God, I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for thee or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen.
John Wesley wrote that exercise, didn't he?
That's right. John Wesley's covenant prayer reminds us that we belong to God, and that no matter what comes our way, we have the power to respond with openness and grace, because God is the one holding our lives. And community at home, you can find a copy of this prayer in our show notes below. Matt, any idea what Coach Paul will have for the Romans next?
Oh, I'm hearing rumors that their next obstacle is going to be strength training.
Well, with all this talk about endurance, that makes a lot of sense. Thanks so much, Matt.
You bet, Jimmy. Take care.
Friends, this is the point in our service where we would typically receive our morning offering. The offering is our opportunity to, in some small way, express our gratitude for all that God has done for us. So as we listen to this musical meditation, I invite you to take a moment to locate that place of gratitude in your own soul. What are you grateful for today? Consider how you're being moved to express that gratitude today with your family, or in your community, or in the world, even in your own heart. If you do feel moved to make a financial gift to Old South United Methodist Church, you can do so by visiting our website, oldsouthumc.org. Prayer connects us to one another and to God, even when we feel far apart. Prayer can make us feel strong and can give us the courage we need to take the next step in our journey of faith. I'll read the names of the folks who are on the prayer list this week, and then allow some moments of silence, during which time I encourage you to speak aloud the names of folks whom you're praying for. Please feel free to share your prayers with one another in the comments below. Today we pray for Faith, Cheryl, Bill, Florence, Dot, Bob and Natalie, Betty, Forrest, Sunday, Anne, Justine, Declan, and all who are homebound. And now in the silence, we lift to you, God, the prayers of our own hearts. Amen. And now, friends, with the boldness of children of God, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father and Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join together in our sung prayer response.
Alleluia, 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 oh Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia, 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 hey, alleluia, alleluia, oh Lord is risen indeed.
He's not in alleluia, the tomb,
alleluia,
he's in the upper room,
alleluia,
he's joining your
alleluia,
Zoom,
alleluia,
hey, oh Lord is risen indeed.
He's not in
alleluia,
the tomb,
alleluia, he's in the upper
alleluia,
room,
alleluia,
he's joining your
alleluia,
Zoom,
alleluia,
yeah, yeah, Lord is risen indeed.
Here are this morning's announcements. Invite you to save the date for a workshop on the book Raising White Kids. Parents of kids high school and younger, join me and my husband, Reverend Will Tanner, in a series of 3 Zoom workshops to practice skills for raising race-conscious and anti-racist kids. Members of both our communities, both Old South and my husband's church, the Plymouth Church in Framingham, are invited to these sessions. We imagine this being like an after hours or after bedtime gathering, and we'll start somewhere between 8 and 9 p.m. based on the feedback that we hear from you all as you RSVP. It'll go no longer than an hour each time. So put the kids to bed, fix yourself a drink, get comfy, and spend an hour with a supportive group of other parents and 2 pastors who parent together about talking about race and anti-racism on the home front. We'll be basing our conversation on the book Raising White Kids by Jennifer Harvey. But while we think that the material in this book will be extremely helpful to you, participants do not need to have read all or any of the book before attending. We, of course, welcome parents raising children of color, though we know that the conversations you will have with your children are at times different than the conversations parents have with white children. So we'll be attentive to that. Dates will be Thursdays, July 9th, July 16th, and July 23rd. We'll make an RSVP form available within the next week. Check your email for a survey or an email inviting you to participate in a brief survey. It should take you less than 10 minutes to complete and will help us to know how you are accessing materials from Old South. It'll help us know how we can be doing better in this time of coronavirus and how you're feeling about the possibility of some small, socially distant, in-person gatherings. Please help us, everyone, by filling this survey out. If you can't figure out how to do it online, please feel free to give me a call and I'm glad to talk you through it. Please continue to join us for evening prayer on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. right here on Facebook Live and on YouTube. This quiet musical service of reflection invites you to lay down the day's burdens and rest a while in God's presence. It's less than a half an hour long and is a good opportunity for you to just take a break. As I mentioned at the top of the service, for the next 2 weeks, you're invited to come virtually to church, decked out in the gear of your favorite team, as we talk about how the game of life has shifted since COVID and how God's rules help us to ride out that change smoothly. I hope you'll have fun with this. And now let's join together in our closing hymn, May You Run and Not Be Weary.
Thank you.
Special thanks today to our lay readers, Julia and Micah, our field correspondent, Matt, Adriana, our one-woman team organ, Richard, who wrote our prayer response, and all of you who, despite your exhaustion and your overwhelm, continue to reflect God's love to a hurting world. And now, beloved, as you go from this place, may the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you now and always. Amen. Zoom coffee hour starts right now. We'll see you there.